We turn now to lecture 14 in our discussion, the Gospel of Luke. We're going to continue what we've been doing in every lecture, talking about the life and time of Jesus Christ, what that particular gospel writer that we're surveying has to say about Jesus Christ, as well as hitting on major theological points. The Gospel of Luke is said to have been written around 80 AD. Scholars who are more liberal with their datings will say as late as 85 AD. It was also written around the same time that Matthew would have been written. And remember what we've said. Scholars believe that both Luke and Matthew were using the Markan source, the Book of Mark, as their sort of framework. And that also there was probably a hypothetical document, the expressions and sayings of Christ, that would have accounted for many things that we find within Matthew and Luke, but don't necessarily find within the Gospel of Mark. We're also going to entertain in this lecture many things that Luke has to say that Matthew doesn't have to say, and that Mark certainly doesn't have to say. So we're also going to be emphasizing the uniqueness of this gospel. Now, modern biblical scholarship says that the writer is anonymous. No one is actually sure who wrote this particular gospel, although it does say Luke in the advent of it. Tradition will maintain, though, that Luke the Evangelist, who was a jack of all trades, he wore many hats, is to be credited for writing this particular gospel as well as the book of Acts. Saint Luke is said to have been a Gentile, firstly, so he was not Jewish. He was a doctor. He says as much within the book of Acts. This is where we learn this. We know that also he's the traveling companion of St. Paul. So he is going to act in many ways as a secretary like John Mark did. And he is going to record St. Paul's travels. Tradition also maintains that Luke was an iconographer, was one of the first iconographers. So have you ever wondered when you see paintings, icons, pictures of Christ, what in the world makes the artist assume what Christ looked like? How do we know what Christ looked like, given that there were no cameras? Are people just more or less working along their own interpretation? Well, I've always found it curious that more or less Christ always looks like Christ. He may differ in terms of skin tone ever so slightly, or perhaps length of hair or facial hair, but you always seem to know that it's him. And the reason for that, tradition maintains, is because in the earliest days of Christ, people were drawing pictures of him. They were putting down his identity, more or less, his physical features. And the first of these iconographers, who was said to have known Christ, not only Christ, but his mother as well, was Saint Luke. And he is actually credited for having produced this icon many, many thousands of years, hundreds of years old, this icon of the Blessed Virgin and her son. Now, let's talk a little bit about the purpose for St. Luke writing this particular book, because he does indeed have a purpose. We said that the purpose of Mark was just to simply put down an account of Christ. There were no other gospels at that point. Remember the purpose of Matthew? To write to the Jewish people about their Messiah who had come. Luke is going to have a very specific purpose, and he is going to state as much within the advent of the first chapter. Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the things that have been accomplished among us, just as those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word have delivered them to us, it seemed good to me also, having followed all things closely for some time past, to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, that you may have certainty concerning the things you have been taught. So, just a few things here that distinguish Luke from the other gospel writers. Firstly, Luke takes the historical account very, very seriously, because, and we know this, because he states his purpose at the very beginning. We don't get a statement of purpose from any other gospel. Luke would have been writing in good Hellenistic fashion, in good scholarly fashion, first stating his claim, stating his purpose. The purpose of this gospel is thus. We know that he takes this particular gospel, what he's doing, very seriously, because he makes use of historical documents and eyewitness accounts, something presumably the other gospel writers had not been doing. You see where he says here, so many people have undertaken to compile a narrative, he says, just as those from the beginning who were eyewitnesses and ministers. This leads us to think, it has been said, that St. Luke actually found the gospels written prior to his, Mark and Matthew, to be somewhat inaccurate, to be incomplete, we might say, or not fulfilling enough. And so this is his purpose, to present an account that's wholly fulfilling, that makes the use of historical accounts and eyewitness accounts. Another interesting feature that's going on here within the advent of this gospel is St. Luke's audience. He's writing, evidently, for an individual who is known as Theophilus. And this has been something that scholars have been interested in for many, many years, many centuries. Who exactly is this Theophilus? Why was St. Luke writing for him? Well, there are a couple of theories. One is that Theophilus could have been a rich benefactor, could have been a Roman citizen, who perhaps commissioned St. Luke to write this orderly account for him. That seems fairly unlikely, though, because, well, quite frankly, why would a Roman official have been interested in the life and time of Jesus Christ? So, it's also been speculated that what's going on here is St. Luke is writing for the people, that he's writing for both Gentiles and Jews, and that this Theophilus is actually a code name. It's a nickname for the body of Christ. Theos, remember, meaning God, and remember the term phileo, meaning love? The name Theophilus, therefore, means a lover of God, beloved of God. And this is simply how he identifies his audience. St. Luke is, therefore, writing for the Christian people. I'd like to do a brief comparison of the genealogy of Christ as it's found within Luke. Remember, we talked about Matthew's genealogy last time, and we said that it's significant because it's really going to capitalize upon the Jewishness of Christ. Remember, we said that the number 14 is highly significant. It's that holy number 7 doubled, and we're going to find three sets of 14 generations in between the father of many nations, Abraham, then David, then the Babylonian captivity. The intention of all of this was to prove to the Jewish people that Christ was that long-awaited Messiah. He wanted, the gospel writer wanted to convince the people, in other words, that Jesus was their man. We said in terms of Christology, remember Christology being the study of the person and nature of Jesus Christ? Christ is very, very Jewish, presented in a very, very Jewish manner. Each particular gospel writer, by the way, has his own Christology, has his own way of understanding Christ. Though I did not mention as much within the Gospel of Mark, Mark's Messiah is typically portrayed as the suffering Messiah, that Messiah who undergoes great agony, as we saw at the very end of the Gospel when he yelled out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? We don't find that in any other Gospel. The point of Christ, though, being the Jewish Messiah within Matthew, is that he has come to save the Jewish people. Now, Luke is going to differ from Matthew in terms of its genealogy, in terms of its intention, and in terms of its Christology. Luke's genealogy of Christ is a fairly impressive one. Instead of simply tracing back to Abraham, Luke is going to go all the way back to the very first person, Adam. The term Adam actually means mankind. And so what Luke is doing here, it's rather subtle. And if you did not necessarily know what Adam meant, then you might miss it. But what Luke's effort is in tracing Christ all the way back to Adam and not just simply stopping at Abraham is explaining to the people that Christ is not only the Savior for the Jewish people, but for all mankind, for everyone who has extended from Adam, which is, of course, everyone who is, in fact, a human being, since Adam was the first man. And for that reason, Luke's intention is to bring about, to offer a Savior, to make known a Savior who has come for all of humanity, not just simply the Jewish people. And it's for that reason Luke's Christology is usually described as the universal Messiah, that salvation has come for all mankind. We see this intention at the very beginning of Luke, within Luke chapter 4, in a story about Christ's rejection at the temple. Now, we've already seen this in Mark chapter 6. Remember, Christ is going to be teaching in the temple. The Pharisees and the scribes are going to hear them. They're going to be amazed. They're not going to know who this man is, but ultimately they are going to reject him. Within Luke chapter 4, this particular story is expounded upon. The text says that after Christ read, he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and then sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him, and he began by saying to them, "Today the scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." And instead of the individuals just simply being amazed, as Mark says, we're told that they got up, they're very angry, they drove him out of town, and they even sought to kill him. They sought to push him off the precipice of a hill. The text tells us that in what I've always considered to be a very, very strange instance, Christ is going to simply walk through the crowd and go about his own way. So he evades the crowd in a very supernatural sort of way. They aren't able to kill him at that moment. So what we see here is the beginning of the rejection of Christ by the Jews. And this is what St. Luke is going to capitalize upon. This is why, in fact, Christ is going to begin to teach to the Gentiles. He came for his own people, but they rejected him. They even tried to kill him. Therefore, salvation has now been brought to all mankind, to all people. We're confronted with another story of rejection. We know that it's not just simply Jesus's hometown people who are rejecting him, but also people abroad. We're told that right after he stills the storm, the story comes right after the stilling of the storm, Christ is going to visit the country of the Gerasenes. And when he steps foot off of his boat onto dry land, he is going to be welcomed by an individual who is said to have lived among the tombs for a long time. This was a demon-possessed man. He wore no clothes. He lived in a cemetery. So this is fairly frightening stuff. The man approaches him and falls down before him, and in a very loud voice yells, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torment me." And this is very reminiscent of what we've already seen within the Gospel of Mark. Remember that very first chapter after Christ begins his ministry. It says that Christ had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man. For many a time it had seized him, the text tells us. The man was kept under guard and was bound in chains and shackles, but he would not break the bonds and be driven by the demon into the desert. And in verse 30, Jesus then asks the man, "What is your name?" And the man is going to reply, "Legion," for many demons had entered him. And they begged him not to command him to depart into the abyss. Now a large herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside, and they begged him to let them enter these. So he gave them the permission, and the demons came out of the man and entered into the pigs, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and drowned. So something that's going on here that the text is not explicit about is that the Jewish people at this time are herding pigs, they're handling pigs, which would have been a huge problem in the first place. Under Jewish dietary regulation, pork is strictly prohibited. So the Jews really had no business keeping pigs in the first place, but nevertheless they were making money off of them. And Christ, in correcting them, this is an attempt to reprimand the Jews, is going to cast these demons out into the nearby pigs so that the pigs, in a moment of traumatic distress, are going to run off the side of the cliff and essentially commit suicide. The text tells us in verse 34, when the herdsmen saw what had happened, they fled and told it to the city and the country. And then the people went out to see what had happened, and they came to Jesus and found the man from whom the demons had left, sitting at the feet of Christ, clothed and in his right mind. And these individuals, the text tells us, were afraid. And those who had seen it told how the demon-possessed man had been healed. Then all the people of the surrounding city of the country of the Gerasenes asked him to depart from them, for they were seized with great fear. So again, another instance of rejection. Rather than these people being grateful that Christ had healed this demon-possessed man who evidently was causing a great deal of havoc within the city, instead of being grateful, they were angry with Christ because he had corrected them. He had basically gotten rid of their welfare. He got rid of their financial prosperity by casting these pigs into the water. And it was for that reason, for these people, Christ was a great inconvenience. So they're going to ask him very politely to leave their place. They want nothing to do with them. Christ has been rejected by his people. He has now become a prophet for all mankind. And I'd like just to look at for a moment this theme of prophet that we find, and to recall something that I mentioned several lectures ago. You'll remember in the book of 1 Samuel, Hannah, Samuel's mother, who wanted a son very, very badly, and she prayed for him. God granted her this son, and she said a prayer. "Because I rejoice in your salvation, there is none holy like the Lord." She promised to dedicate her son, who would become a prophet, to the temple and put him under a Nazarite vow. She sees the birth of her son as being something that will strengthen the people. The bows of the mighty are broken, but the feeble bind are strengthened. Those who were full have hired themselves out for bread, but those who were hungry have ceased to hunger. Samuel is considered to be a Messiah, a prophet for the Jewish people. The Magnificat, what is referred to as the Magnificat, or Mary's prayer, the mother of Christ, her prayer to God after she has been told by the Archangel Gabriel that she too will have a son, that she too will give birth to an individual who is going to be the Messiah, the Savior for mankind. This particular prayer, this Magnificat, is very, very similar if you compare to that of Hannah. Mary says, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked on the humble estate of his servant. For behold, from now on, all generations will call me blessed. And this is why the Christian tradition refers to her as the Blessed Virgin. For he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of humble estate. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. So now we understand this Christ as the Messiah, the prophet, who has come not only to save Jews, but also Gentiles, but also those who are suffering, those who are of lowly estate, those who have not previously prospered. So it has been said that this particular gospel is one that is very conscientious of social justice, and I would agree with that. That, in fact, Christ is very attentive, very aware of the poor, of the downtrodden, and he is going to seek to minister to them in a way that we have not previously seen within Matthew and Mark. Here is an icon of the Annunciation being the visiting of the Archangel Gabriel to the Blessed Virgin, and you'll see right down the middle the Spirit in the form of a dove flying down upon her at the conception. And this is a feast day within the traditional Christian church. The traditional Christian church celebrates these special events throughout. Of course, you were familiar with some, Easter and Christmas, for example. But there are other great days, like the Annunciation, which is said to have been March 25th. This would have been right around the time that Christ was conceived, and other great feast days as well. So, further prophetic themes that we're going to find within this gospel, and themes to tie Christ into the prophets of the Old Testament. There is a very strong link there. Christ is going to teach very much like a prophet teaches. Christ is going to use language like today the scripture is fulfilled, like we saw within Matthew, and it has been done in your hearing. This is in very good Mosaic fashion. Christ is going to heal like a prophet. We're told within Luke chapter 17 about several individuals who are going to be healed of their leprosy. Picking up in verse 11, the text tells us, on the way to Jerusalem, Christ was passing along between Samaria and Galilee, and as he entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers who stood at a distance and lifted up their voices, saying, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. When he saw them, he said to them, go and show yourselves to the priest. And as they went, they were cleansed. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. And he fell on his face at Christ's feet, giving him thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus answered, were not 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner? And he said to him, rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well. Presumably, the other 9 were Jesus' own people. They were, in fact, Jewish, but they were ungrateful, evidently. Only the Gentile would return and show his thankfulness. Again, Christ, who was very conscientious of not only Jews, but also Gentiles as well, and these Gentiles being very appreciative and grateful for what Christ has done. The story parallels to one that we find within 1 Kings chapter 17. The story goes that Elijah, remember, who was a great prophet, is going to go by the voice of the Lord to a place called Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and he is supposed to dwell there for a period of time. In the meantime, God has commanded a widow to come and take care of Elijah. And the text tells us that Elijah goes to the city, and as he is hanging out near the city gates, a widow is going to come up. And Elijah is going to request from her to give him a little bit of water to drink. And she's going to bring it to him, and he's going to then request some bread. And the text tells us that Elijah is going to come and stay with this woman for a period of time. But after a little while, the woman's son is going to become sick, and he is going to die. The text tells us that his illness was so severe that there was no breath left in him. And the woman is going to become very anxious, very upset, and she is going to say, "What have you against me, O man of God? You have come to me to bring my sin to remembrance and to cause the death of my son." And he says to her, "Give me your son." And he took him from her arms and carried him up into the upper chamber where he lodged and laid him down on the bed. And he cried to God, "O Lord my God, have you brought calamity even upon the widow with whom I sojourn by killing her son?" And it's said that Elijah is then given the power to give life back to the child, the text tells us. And the child is going to be revived. It's the word that's used. And Elijah is going to take the child and bring him back to his mother. So we see Christ is able to heal like the prophets. Not only that, he's also going to heal foreigners, much like Elijah did as well, thus bringing salvation to the entire Jewish, or into the entire world, not just the Jewish people. Christ is also going to suffer and die like a prophet. All of the prophets who have been persecuted before him, prophets like Jeremiah, prophets like Elijah, prophets like Moses, Christ is going to suffer in much of the same manner, also fulfilling that suffering servant that we find within the book of Isaiah. In any case, Christ says when his suffering is impending, he tells the disciples that he must keep going, for surely no prophet can die outside of Jerusalem, likening himself to the prophets before him. I want to stop and talk about then the crucifixion as we understand it within the book of Luke and compare it to the crucifixion account that we find within Mark. Again, we're going to see a very fulfilled story, a much more complete story. Remember, within the Gospel of Mark, I said that Mark tends to portray Christ as the suffering Messiah. Christ's agony is extreme. It's both psychological and physical. It's said that he was under great distress, that to the point he began to sweat blood, quite literally, and that his physical pain was unimaginable. He says in the Garden of Gethsemane, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death." In other words, he is so depressed, he is so stressed about what is just about to happen to him. He's almost about to die just from the acute distress. Within the Gospel of Mark, Christ is going to ask his Father to thus spare him of his death. We're told that he says that, we're told that as he is on his way to the Garden of Gethsemane, out of deep stress, he is going to fall down to the ground right where he is, and he is going to begin to beg and plead that the cup may pass from him. "Abba, Father," he said, "everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, your will be done." Christ's unwillingness to speak during the trial and crucifixion, perhaps because his distress is so great, is illustrated within the Gospel of Mark 2. He doesn't say very much at all. In fact, the only thing that he does say at the point of crucifixion is this, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" Again, a Messiah who is under deep distress, who is suffering greatly. This Messiah is different from the Messiah that we find within the Gospel of Luke. By all accounts, this Messiah seems fairly composed as compared to the one within the Gospel of Mark. Instead of Christ, for example, praying three times that he be spared the pain of death, actually, Christ this time is only going to ask once. Moreover, rather than falling down to the ground, collapsing in a moment of great distress and agony, instead, Christ, very composed, kneels down to the ground and he prays, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet again, not my will, your will be done." Another interesting feature, Christ is actually going to have conversations with individuals as he is going up to Golgotha. As we just said a moment ago, Christ within the Gospel of Mark is not going to have anything to say at all. He's going to be quite silent, in fact. Christ within Luke is going to have conversations with the women. He is going to deliver his woe oracles, and there's going to be a great deal of distress on their behalf, whereas we didn't necessarily see that as much within the Gospel of Mark. Instead of Christ's words within the Gospel of Luke, his last words being, my God, why have you forsaken me? Instead, Christ says, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Instead of wondering why God had abandoned him, instead he recognizes that God is with him and he gives over his spirit. There's an added story, by the way, within the crucifixion narrative of Christ, and this actually comes right before the crucifixion, the apprehension itself. So they're all in the Garden of Gethsemane. Christ has been praying. The Roman soldiers come in to apprehend Christ. And instead of Christ willfully going along with the individuals and everyone else scattering, what we see is a fight that ensues. And the text tells us that Peter is going to draw out his sword and he is going to strike one of the servants of the high priest on the ear. And when he does, he slices off his ear. And Christ, once again, in a moment of great mercy, feeling sorry for everyone, willing to heal, is said to have touched where the man's ear was and fully restored it, fully healed it. He says, no more of this. If you live by the sword, you're going to die by the sword. Once again, a Christ very interested in social justice. I'd like to talk about, for just a little while, the crucifixion itself, the purpose of it, why it was necessary for Christ to die, and how it's traditionally been understood within the two main churches, the Western Church and the Eastern Church. Well, one thing that both churches maintain, that the entire Christian church maintains, is that the purpose of Christ's crucifixion was for the atonement of individuals. This term atonement literally means at-one-ment, and it's going to be through Christ's crucifixion that man is going to be made at one with God. In other words, it's going to take that crucifixion for man to be brought back into the presence of God. This is what ultimately justifies him. Having said all that, though, it is a point of great debate exactly how this atonement plays itself out, exactly how it is carried out. And as I said a moment ago, there are generally two theories as to what's going on within this moment of atonement. Within the Western Church, it is known as the satisfaction theory, and within the Eastern Church, it's the Christus Victor theory. Let's talk about both of these. The satisfaction theory within the Western Church, remember the Western Church being that of the Catholic Church and the Protestant Church, works more or less like this. According to the Western model, mankind is so utterly corrupt that it has become impossible for sins to be forgiven in and of man's own effort. Remember, previously within the Old Testament, we see mankind's sins, or at least the Jewish people's sins, being forgiven by a sacrifice. But by the time of Christ, the sin debt had accrued so much that the offerings being presented, the offerings being sacrificed, were more or less incomplete. They were inadequate, in other words. And it was for that reason that God desired a pure sacrifice, a sacrifice that would ultimately assuage and appease his wrath forever. Christ is this ultimate sacrifice. Because Christ was sinless, only he could properly pay this debt, forgiving the sins of all mankind. This model tends to privilege, therefore, Christ's passion, his ultimate suffering on behalf of all mankind, and his crucifixion, that which would properly pay that debt that mankind had accrued. The Eastern Church tends to understand things a bit differently. So instead of understanding man as ultimately corrupt, as God being very angry and needing his wrath appeased, and as Christ as that appeasement, instead of understanding Christ as that debt payer for a very corrupt mankind, instead, the Eastern model tends to think of Christ as that individual who is going to destroy death. So in other words, it's not so much death that is going to destroy Christ for our sakes and for God's appeasement, but rather Christ, who is going to destroy death. He is going to be that great conqueror. And remember, this is precisely what happens, we said last time, on Holy Saturday. After Christ's crucifixion, he is going to trample down death, as the famous hymn sings. He is going to conquer death. And it's going to be by virtue of his conquering death that mankind is now able to enter into God. He is able to be saved, in other words. This model, therefore, is going to privilege the resurrection more. Now, I want to be clear about something, so note well. It's not the case that these positions are mutually exclusive. In other words, it's not the case that the Western Church doesn't think that the resurrection is as significant in the Christian's salvation, his atonement. It's not the case that the Eastern Church believes that the Passion and Crucifixion are not essential to atonement. Both are quite necessary to atonement, to ultimate salvation. But once again, it's a question of privileging, it's a question of emphasis, what is ultimately embraced more. I think that this is played out very well within St. Paul's letter to the Corinthians, his very first letter. At one point in chapter 2, verse 2, he says that he preaches Jesus Christ and him crucified. This message of passion and crucifixion is essential to the gospel. But nevertheless, he says, had Christ not been raised, then this is pointless. He would have just been like any other criminal. Resurrection is essential to the gospel, otherwise faith is in vain. So we see the two working together in what is known as the communicatio idiomatum in Latin, the sharing of properties. I think that this verse from Revelation works really well to illustrate this idea too. The Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed. He speaks of him as the Lamb who has been slain, the one who has suffered, the one who has been crucified, the one who has been ridiculed, the one who has succumbed to the wrath of God, but nevertheless, the one who has emerged victorious, the one who has saved mankind. Now, there are a few other additional themes that I'd like to discuss just for a moment, themes that we aren't necessarily going to find, once again, within the other Gospels. Additional themes include the Holy Spirit, an emphasis placed on the Holy Spirit and the joy brought by the Holy Spirit, anticipating the book of Acts. Remember I said that Luke is also the writer of the book of Acts, so his gospel in many ways is going to serve as one end of the bookend of the work of Luke Acts. At that time, Jesus, full of joy through the Holy Spirit, it said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this was your good pleasure. We don't see joy stressed as much throughout Matthew and throughout Mark, certainly. Certainly, Mark is a gospel that is extremely mysterious in character and does emphasize the Christ who suffers. Within Matthew, I think it's easily argued that Christ is very austere within this gospel, very severe at times, very condemnatory even. But within Luke, we see him slightly more relaxed, we might say, and full of joy, as the text tells us. Another interesting feature, one that we talked about last time, Luke's eschatology is somewhat different from that of Matthew's. He seemed to think that the end was imminent and not futuristic. Remember, the kingdom of God for Luke is going to be within the individual rather than being on the outside of the individual in a time to come, as we see it within the book of Matthew. Jesus is also going to be illustrated as the healer, as we've said throughout this particular lecture, the healer who was concerned with the welfare of the people. Heal the sick and tell them the kingdom of God is near you. These are his instructions for his disciples. Woman, you are set free of your infirmity. We get the story of a woman who has been bent over for about 18 years. And this is a metaphor, in fact, for Israel, and Israel who has been bent over in the Roman yoke. This woman has been bent over, crooked for 18 years. Christ is going to put his hands on her. Remember his own deifying body. He is going to touch her, and she is going to straighten up, much like Israel shall, and praise God. One other thing that I want to talk about just for a moment. We talked about this within Matthew, but I want to compare it to that of Luke, what we've already said, the Beatitudes. Remember we said that the Beatitudes are a catalog for how a Christian ought to behave. These Beatitudes that we find within Luke are going to differ from what we find within Matthew, I think mostly in the emphasis of social justice. So we see within the Gospel of Matthew, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Christ in Luke is going to abbreviate this. He's going to give us the abridged version, and he simply says, blessed are those of you who are poor. So perhaps those who are not only impoverished in spirit, but who are also suffering from malnutrition and an inability to pay their bills, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness' sake, Christ says within Matthew, for they will be satisfied. Within Luke, blessed are you who are simply hungry, for you will be satisfied as well. An additional thing that we get with the Beatitudes, something that is referred to as the similitudes, we don't get within Matthew, but Christ offers some woe oracles, in other words, correcting those who might not be acting within accordance of the Beatitudes. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation, he says. Woe to you who are full now, for you are going to be hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you are going to mourn and weep. Once again, Christ, who is very interested in the welfare of the poor, of those who are suffering. I'd like to look at a little bit of commentary on the Beatitudes for just a moment. Once again, just introducing you to a little bit of Christian exegesis. This was written by St. Maximus. His name day is August 12th. Today actually is August 12th when I'm delivering this lecture to you. And the church recognizes and celebrates St. Maximus as being a contributor to Christian theology. And he interprets the Beatitudes like so. This is very moving stuff. He says, there are many people in the world who are poor in spirit, but not in the way that they should be. Many people who, in other words, are humble, but not in quite the right manner. There is good humility, and there is false humility. There is genuine meekness, and there is the meekness that simply wants to get attention, that simply feels sorry for itself, and St. Maximus is distinguishing here. There are those who mourn, but for some financial loss or for the death of their children, not who mourn after righteousness' sake, the wrong kind of mourning, or not the best kind of mourning, we might say. Many are gentle, but towards unclean passions. Remember, those passions are the things which afflict us, which tempt us to sin, essentially. And we'll be talking about passions more when we get to 1 Corinthians. Many in hunger and thirst, but only to seize what does not belong to them, to profit from injustice, those who are greedy. Many are merciful, but instead toward their bodies and to the things that serve their bodies, not to other individuals. In other words, they privilege themselves. They're more merciful toward themselves than they are others. Many are pure in heart, but for the sake of pride, for the sake of self-esteem, for feeling good about themselves. Many are peacemakers, but by making the soul submit to the flesh instead. Many are persecuted, but as wrongdoers. Many are reviled, but for shameful sins. I'd like to conclude this lecture with a theme that I've been talking about within every one of my lectures. Remember what I've been saying? The gospel purpose, for the reader to identify who Christ is. And we get the story once again within the Gospel of Luke. We're told Christ asked the disciples, who do men say that I am? They are going to reply, St. John, Elijah, one of the prophets from long ago. Peter, this time, is going to reply slightly differently, but not that much, essentially the same thing. You are the Christ, the Son of, you are the Christ of God. Now, instead of Christ telling Peter, don't tell anyone, as he did in Mark, and instead of blessing him and conferring upon him the keys to the church, instead of Christ, in other words, revealing more about himself, and saying that he is going to go and be crucified and persecuted and raised on the third day, what he instead prefers to do is talk about the individual self. And this, for me, is probably one of the greatest, most thought-provoking passages that we find within all of the Gospels. He says to them all, "If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will save it. What good is it for a man to gain the entire world, yet lose it for his very self? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his glory and in the glory of the Father and the holy angels. I tell you the truth, some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God." So I'd encourage you to think about that final passage. It's a very, very, very deep passage, not to be understood superficially. What exactly does it involve? What does it mean to deny oneself? What does it mean to die that one might find himself? What manner of death is this? And consider that perhaps for some discussion on Blackboard. I have a few other questions here for you that you might be interested in entertaining. We're going to be turning to the Gospel of John next time, so be sure to keep up with your reading. The Gospel of John happens to be my favorite gospel. Christ in this particular gospel is unlike the Christ, certainly, that we find within the Synoptic Gospels, a very different Christ indeed. I hope that everyone is keeping up with the reading and keeping up with the material. As always, like I say within every lecture, if you have any questions, be sure to get in touch with me. Thanks, guys.